Julian.
Thank you so much. And thank you all for coming. I'm really glad I can tell you a little bit about all this health data. It's going to make me a little nervous because I haven't shared all of this with people before. So we'll see how it goes. I did ask for a short introduction because I just have to admit I am Narcistic. And that word needs a little definition because I made it up. And the people who were type editing the conference program didn't realize that. So all over the conference it says Narcistic. Which is the word it's based off, plus statistic, but it's Narcistic. So I'm going to start off with that definition. It's an adjective. And it's statistically self-centered with an exaggerated sense of importance about data about oneself. True. Often marked by a characteristic of excessive admiration of or infatuation with one's own data. Also true. It also has a second definition, displaying or marked by excessive concern with the completeness, reliability, and validity of one's own personal data, also true to an extreme extent, as we'll see today. So I am Narcistic, and I hope you know today I can share with you some things that I've learned by being that way, and maybe convince you that it's not that bad of a thing after all. Okay, so first, just so you can convince you that I kind of am, this is what I look at every morning when I get up. This is my daily view. I have a 4K monitor, so it's pretty big, and I put all my health data up with current dashboards and indicators and things I've done to either reward or shame myself for the previous day's performance. So we'll talk through some of these. I'm not going to show in depth how I make everything. I promise I am going to record a series of videos. They'll be on the Jump blog, going through in detail how to do some of these things that require a little bit more background, some of the work with APIs we could spend a whole talk on. But so that at least should convince you a little bit about what I do with my data. Now, I collect data from a lot of sources. Like most people who are Narcistic, it doesn't start with just everything at once. It builds on itself, like all good disorders. I should say, my doctorate is in psychology, so maybe I'm qualified here. I'm not a clinical psychologist, so maybe not. But I'll make jokes about that throughout. So it started with a Fitbit. I got back actually in 2013, but I really didn't start using until 2015 extensively. I'll talk about why. That escalated quickly. I bought the Aria Fitbit Scale. So that connects and it, you know, combines all the data for you within Fitbit. It's Wi-Fi, so I don't have to type anything in. I'll talk about this a lot. If you can be lazy with your data collection, that's great. I got an Apple Watch eventually. And that was nice, that added heart rate. Another calculation of steps and distance. I actually lost that Fitbit and they discontinued it, so I had to buy a different one. So that's the Fitbit Flex I got. I didn't lose the Apple Watch, but I stopped using it because I switched over to my Garmin when I started running later on. So that's the one I'm wearing now. I actually still carry a Garmin plus a Fitbit because two sources of data are better than one. So even though it collects the same thing, that's what I have. See? Narcistic. These all interact great with apps, and that's how I eventually get my data, with Fitbit, my Fitness Pal for consumption. I've logged for 4 years almost every single thing I've eaten, and those data are kind of fun. Strava, once I got into running, I'll talk about later. Garmin also for running, that's what my Garmin watch connects to, but I end up connecting it with Strava as well. And something called the Quantified Self-Access app, which helps you get stuff out of the Apple Health Kit. And I used this for a while, but I actually stopped using it because Jump got so good at importing from XML that I can just pull it directly into Jump. So we'll talk about that. Okay, but I got to give you a little backstory. Like I said, I didn't really start this tracking until really about March of 2015, or sorry, May of 2015. And I'll tell you about the reasons why in a second, but I want to give you some context to sort of who I was at that point, because that was a point in my life where I really was honestly the most unhealthy I'd ever been. It got to a point where I was the heaviest I'd ever been and just really wasn't taking care of things. So I want to show you a clip from a very short-lived Jump mini-series that we did just to give you the context of me.
How's it going?
I don't know. I just don't think I can make this work. There's so much data, all these states. The graph looks like, yes.
All right, let's break that down for a second. Chuck says, there's so much data with all these states, the graph looks like spaghetti. And the writers for this show thought, Julian should say, that makes me hungry, whilst I'm eating a sandwich, which was a shtick that went throughout the whole series. And I don't blame the writers, this was funny, we came up with this together, and it fit the persona at that time. I wasn't always eating sandwiches, but I love sandwiches, so that's fine. But really, the change happened not because I was shamed into seeing myself in a different way because of the miniseries, but I had a slow escalation of a relationship that I was very unhappy with. I don't know if any of you have been in a relationship you're unhappy with. I didn't have the courage to end it, and so I got more and more frustrated, more and more unhappy, and just let myself go. And I reached a sort of a breaking point where I had to make a change. And I did, and it was hard, but that led to this really period of self-evaluation where I said, okay, I'm going to make a lot of changes at once. This is going to be a hellish period anyway. I might as well do all the things that I want to change all at once, which, if you ask anyone who's actually into making lasting change, is not really the way you should do it. But for me, that works well. I have an endurance for really hard things, and I could do them all at once. And so I thought, okay, I'm going to make these changes. So in, well, let me back up and say, I found this quote from Lao Tzu right around that time. New beginnings are often disguised as painful endings, and that really sat with me because that's what it felt like. And so I started doing things that I thought I should do for a long time, but never did. So in June 2015, I bought myself a treadmill desk. I'd wanted one for years, and I finally went out and just bought it. This is one made by Lifespan. I didn't actually use their raising or lowering desk because I don't think that way. I don't want that. I had a home office at the time and a home studio, so I built it into my home office studio, which, if you can see in the back, I mean, it's just as ridiculous as you would expect. I have my huge screen. It's all soundproofed around. There's my treadmill desk at the bottom. This is actually a big, it's actually a shot put that I just used to toss around because I figured passive exercise. So purely ridiculous. But this was huge for me. So getting this as a way of passively getting exercise and steps started me on a path. And actually, I credit a lot of what comes from this really to that treadmill desk. I can't talk it up really enough. So I want to break apart now to jump and talk about the first 7 days, because really that first little bit of tracking was, I don't know, honestly quite interesting to me. And let's look at a couple things. Scripting a file import, because like I said, if you can be lazy about your data, that's great as long as it stays complete. Creating the first health dashboard I ever created, and then some forecasting I was able to do. Okay, so the first 7 days, I'm just going to pull open this data table. And one thing you'll notice, I have the time listed out to 40 days. And in my head, this was sort of the event envelope that I was trying to constrain. I figured, okay, for 40 days, I'm going to plan what I'm going to do, and I'm going to make the changes in this time. So I filled down my date and had that be the endpoint. These were the first 7 days that I actually had. And normal things you would expect, calories, steps, distance, consumption, so calories consumed. And then wonderfully, Fitbit gives you some things like minutes sedentary, active, fairly active, etc. And so I was able to put these together in my first dashboard, which looked like this, where I had at the bottom this visualization of, and I'll zoom in for those of you further back, this is an area plot showing area of calorie deficit, how many calories were burned within an area of there. I had weight. This is actually showing sodium, and I'll talk about that later. Sodium 2 days ago predicts deflection from where I should weigh, basically if you retain water. Plots of activity. So sedentary, lightly active, very active, then distance. And you'll see I quickly ramped up. I had my first 15-mile day walking only on the third day, and that'll continue to get more extreme. Let me talk through actually building this, because if you haven't made a graph like this in Graph Builder, I think you'll appreciate how easy it is. We're just going to take the date, put it there. I have sort of a main variable section, and so we had calories burned and consumed. I'll add those in first, and I'll make it an area plot. And that's actually a range area plot, so it's distance between them. And then the next one up was I had weight and predicted weight. And so where's weight? I just had weight in this one. We'll talk about predicted weight a little bit later. It's trying to do an area plot. I'll change that to just points right now and actually add that. I'll put a line there too. The next one was activity, so that's under activity here. I didn't actually use sedentary because it's just a big block of it. And I'll actually change those points to be a bar and make that bar a stacked bar, which is kind of cool. And then I'll drop the line. Let's remove that. And then finally, there was a sort of a steps plus distance. So the first thing I added was steps as bars. And then I wanted to have this idea of total cumulative distance. How far have I gone? And so I added that here. They're on a different scale. So I took that one, moved it to the right as cumulative distance, and then made that bar on the right, changed that to be a line. And there we go. So that's essentially the dashboard we're going to see over and over. It's the stacked sort of sections of things that I was caring about watching. And then I just embellished it a bit to make it something that I like looking at. One thing I realized, if you don't like looking at your graphs, about your health data, you're not going to look at them every day. So you can make yourself want to see something, then you actually look at it. And that ended up being really motivating for me. Now, one other thing happened that I realized by having these data, I could predict lots of things. In fact, it's pretty easy to predict how many calories you burn based on every step you take. And with a little bit of working backwards, I can take something like a goal weight. I gave myself a pretty extreme goal, 30 pounds in 40 days. And I said, okay, how far would I have to walk each day? How many steps would I have to take if I want to hit that goal weight, presuming some fixed calorie intake? And just out of luck, I happened to be going to a dentist appointment, and my dentist has a nutritionist that you can see along with your appointment. And so I brought this whole plan, and she was like, that's ridiculous, but then said, okay, if you're going to do it, here's what you need to do to be careful. And so what I ended up building was a prediction dashboard. Looked just like what you saw, but forecasting out the 30 days. And it turned out I had to walk something like 31,000 steps a day, would be how many steps I'd need to walk if I want to hit that goal weight. But armed with this idea of a treadmill desk and the ability to quite frankly, add a huge amount of passive exercise to my workday, and being kind of a workaholic, this worked pretty well, I was able to, as you'll see in a second, get pretty far with this. And so this is that same dashboard from the 40 days, and you'll see I ramp up kind of quickly here. I had my first day above 25 miles on day 12, and then by the end of the time here, I was hitting days of 30 miles a day. That's 60,000 steps. And so literally just walking for 8 hours a day. And it turned out for me, that little bit of passive exercise is hugely motivational and powerful for focus. I can just attend to something pretty much exclusively if I'm just passively walking along. And it turned out by the end of 40 days, I had hit that, 177 pounds. So I made it down 30 pounds at that point. And there's some other things we'll talk about actually in this plot, and I'll just switch back over to jump. In that first 40 days that I thought was really cool, is I came up with this idea of a predicted weight. Because if you've ever dieted, you probably have noticed your weight fluctuates from day to day, and that's due to a lot of factors. For me, I noticed this due very heavily to sodium consumption, not too surprising, especially the lag too of sodium. But what was frustrating was, you know, you drop a few pounds, and then you feel really good one day, and then you gain some back, but you're not really gaining or losing pound. Your true weight is fixed, and it's changing based on the calories you consume and the deficit you're throwing for a day. Your weight from each day is a random function around that. Not really random, but a function of a lot of different variables. And so what I did is I made a predicted weight column. And that predicted weight column, which I have over here, is simply a formula based on total cumulative deficit in terms of pounds, which is just a calculation of deficit in terms of calories divided by 3,500, the number of calories in a pound. And it turns out that if you look at the plot, that's going to track really well, as long as I'm tracking well, with my predicted weight, or my real weight. So you see my real weight is in blue there, the dotted line showing a prediction is in dotted line, and it's stable from day to day in the sense that it's just declining without a lot of random fluctuations. There I ate, a lot of sodium that day. And so you can see the next day, my weight's lofted off of the predicted weight. But it turned out that this was a hugely motivational thing because it kept me from focusing on these day-to-day fluctuations that can be either overly motivating or overly dissuading you of kind of continuing. And it really led me to really believe this calories in, calories out is totally true. That's not like a made-up thing with health. And you just have to track really carefully. There was one bit here I was traveling. You can see my daily steps dropped off precipitously. I traveled a lot for work. I was working remotely. Luckily, those first 40 days, I wasn't traveling a lot, so I got to really focus on this sort of health initiative for myself. But I did have a conference that I went to, and I tried really hard. I got, you know, a couple days with 10 miles in it, you know, really walking around the conference hall like a lunatic. People are like, what is this person doing? So actually, I had one person that saw me doing this, and they're like, Fitbit? I'm like, yeah. they know. All right, so that's the first 40 days. All right, so August 2015, I had finished my 40 days. I was really jazzed, and I thought, okay, I'm gonna keep this up. By 40 days, you've really made a habit. That's how long it takes to really instantiate this for yourself. And things changed a bit. I started traveling more for work. I did have some huge days. The first time I hit 80,000 steps in a day, 40 miles in a day. was around August. And I realized I really, really love doing this. My cat's in my bag before I travel. When I went traveling, though, I really made an effort to go places and walk around. I was in a conference in El Paso, and I drove out to New Mexico and saw the Carlsbad Caverns. But I walked all around, you know, just over the weekend. So I really made it a part of my habit, a part of my day, to be this person who was moving, a person who was active. I hit my first 100,000 step day in October. This is 50 miles in a single day. It turns out I'm very susceptible to gamification because Fitbit gives you little badges every time you hit a step goal. And once I hit 80,000, I was like, well, I clearly have to get to 100,000, which is the top step goal. With all apologies to my friends on Fitbit, a few of them who are at this conference, and they literally told me they defriended me after this because this is your weekly steps. And so some of them were just like, well, Julian's no longer my friend. I'm taking you off. So with no shame to those people there, 374,000 steps in a week is kind of extreme in our statistic. Okay, so just to look at this, I'm going to switch over to really the current iteration of the data set. I'll just minimize the side here, because what I'm going to do is pull open a data filter, and we're going to talk about those first, really, all the days up to November 29th, because I want to show you something. And so I'm going to pull open a version of that dashboard. And actually, let me do the simplified version of it. And so what we're looking at is everything from when I started, day zero, as I consider it, all the way up to really this 11/28. And you can see if I click off here, those first 40 days were the most. I changed my goals such that I wasn't, you know, throwing an extreme calorie deficit to sort of level off. And then I hit a pretty solid state point. You know, there's my 100,000 step day. You can see it sticking out as an outlier there. But I hit kind of like a steady state. And by the end of this little term, I was up to something like 1,400 miles. And so pretty far. But if I peek forward, I want to show you something that happens. And this has maybe happened to a lot of you who have dieted or anything that you've tried. Things fall off, routines change. You'll notice if you look at just the calories plot, I changed it up. So the bars basically turn red if it's a day where I threw a non-deficit, and green if I threw a deficit. So days that it's red, it's just eating more than I burned. And the preponderance of those days increases. You'll see there's more and more of them. So in some ways, this could be considered discouraging, but it actually happened because of a particular event. It happened on November 29th, 2015, and it happened at a Costco. Do you guys know Costco? Okay, good. It wasn't that they started selling the 6-kilogram Nutellas, but they did. I've never bought them, but you can't really see the size here, but they're obscene. The change was actually a happy one. It was the day I met Margot. And I'll tell you about Margot. We're both nerds. This is us going to a lightsaber. We're actually battle. Yeah, you go battle lightsabers. But that was the day I met Margot. And things change when you meet people because, well, your routines have to change. And so I found out very quickly that my routines, albeit solid for me, even in the face of changes in my own life, they're still fragile in the face of big life changes, because that's what routines are like sometimes. And so if we track this from the day I met Margot, 11/29, you'll see I kind of held on for a bit, more red days, because we were going out to dinner, that kind of thing. I couldn't be so controlling about what I did. But then just sort of fell off a bit, and it seems like it's just escalating a bit throughout the March and February time. And so by March, there were some big changes. And so what I didn't tell you is that when I first met Margot, she told me that she was applying to grad school, and she had actually already applied by the time we met, which put kind of a very sad end date on our relationship. And March is when you find out about grad schools. That's when she was going to find out when she got in places. So coming up to this endpoint was kind of stressful for both of us. And she got into all sorts of great schools. She got into Emory, got into to several places she really wanted, but she got into the place she wanted most, which was the University of North Carolina in Chapel Hill. And for those of you who don't know the geography, SAS headquarters is in North Carolina. It's in fact only 15 miles from the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill. So at 4 months of dating, Margot asked me, do I want to move across the country with her to North Carolina from San Diego, where I'd lived for the last 12 years? It took me a day before I agreed. And this was a Lao Tzu quote I found around then. You know, being deeply loved by somebody gives you strength, but loving somebody deeply gives you courage. And boy, do I love Margot. And that gave me the courage to take that home office I had, break it down, excess of wires, to pack everything I owned in life and put it on a truck and send it across the country, you know, to say bye to the best friends we'd ever had, to watch the sunset one last time over the Pacific. Put everything we owned still that I wasn't sent away into the back of a van with a space for the cats that I built them, you know, a little like double-decker place. Travel across the country, see as many cool things as we can, and get to North Carolina to unpack our van in a really hot summer. And people told me it was going to be sweaty, hot, and humid, but I did not understand what that meant. Coming from California, where I lived in basically a desert, to an office that didn't really resemble the home office I had built for myself. You know, one that didn't have the affordances of the walking and all that. And new challenges. There are mixed nuts on every floor in the SAS building, and they just beckon to me every time I walk by them. So that's an ongoing challenge that I'm trying to face. But you'll notice if we look at this, there's actually when we were driving, that's when I lost that Fitbit the first time. Somewhere in Nashville, I think I lost it. I'm not sure. But from this is March down here up to October 26th in 2016, it was a slow ramp up. And I had these areas shaded by sort of like how alarmed should I be with myself? And I was trickling back up into a place where I said, this is alarming and I needed to make a change. And you can see the steps from day to day have been going down and finally got to this place where, you know, I was at the place I was before I even started this whole health thing. And that led to really a need for a new change. I needed to reevaluate my goals and really come together with something new. So I took that office on campus, made it look like something I wanted, added backlights and other stuff to make it cool. I rebuilt my home office now within Chapel Hill. Not as good as before because we rented this house, and so I didn't want to like too destroy the walls. But got the deposit back, so we're good. But rebuilt that and then found around the same time that I can download my data directly from Fitbit using something called the Fitbit Scraper. Right around this time, Jump certainly for a while had supported the R to Jump connection. So I can recruit a package on CRAN to actually download my Fitbit data. And this gave me the ability to look at intraday, what's happening within a day. And so actually I had, at that time, my biggest month of the year, or month of all time, in November, where I hit over 1 million steps in a month. And if you look at my day-to-day, you can see, and I was still traveling a lot for work, so this required, you know, certain days to be offset by really big days with 50 and 60,000 steps. There's one day in here, I was at a conference, and that's the day like I got a lot of looks because I was really just circling the conference hall the whole time. It's just, I must have looked like a lunatic. But I got there. Then this is also when I started this new kind of graph that I felt really motivated by. It's kind of a streaks graph. And I'll show you what this looks like actually in Jump. But you can see this big climb here of these mountains right around the end of October. And what this is plotting is just how many days in a row I've hit a particular goal. And this ended up being really motivating for me to look at because it's like you're climbing a mountain. And so you don't want to let yourself down and fall to the bottom of the mountain again. And so that became this real motivating thing. And so let me just show you a little bit of that. And so let me change my filter set here and let's take it to 3 to 15. So that was the plot. Let me go forward here. There we go, 1026. So I had this big block of green at the bottom for those of you in the back who can't see, doing great. That's a big thing to look at for me. But the streaks were kind of fun. So if I pull open my streaks, and let me just reset the axis here. What it's really doing is for every day that I hit a goal, and if I look in the table, let's actually expand this. So I have a streak column, and let me get to a place where I've not had the filter on. There we go. Really what it's doing is how many days in a row something has happened. So if I hit a goal multiple days in a row, it counts up to 2. If I don't, it drops to -1. And so all it's really doing is that incremental counting. And the way this plot works, if I just build a simple one, I just add the date in here, it's really as simple as putting that streak column in. Here I'll do streaks for how many days in a row I've hit 10,000. And I just put on a bar. Now, what's tricky, let me expand the range. The only thing you didn't see in that plot was the negative side, which I purposely left out. So that's how many days in a row I haven't hit that. And that became too demotivating for me to see. I thought it would be great at first. Like, oh, if I'm at negative 10 days in a row, like I'm going to turn it around today. That was going to be the motivation. For me in my head, that was, well, I'm already 10 days not doing this. What's 11 going to mean? So I just hid that. I just went to the axis settings and said, okay, just show me positive streaks. And that felt a little more comfortable for Julian, you know? So the streaks ended up being kind of cool. That was a way to look at a lot of different goals in one chart. And it was kind of cool to see the mound of them building up across all these different categories. And so, that was right around that time. Now for Fitbit raw data, I'm going to come back at the end. Fitbit are scraper package. The person stopped developing it and Fitbit changed their API structure. And so it's broken now, but I'll talk later about using our own API connection to pull directly from Fitbit. So no need to go through R. All right, May 2017, something big happened for me, which is when I added Strava and other running metrics. And it happened, I was at a conference in Boston, and this is me, it was rainy outside, I was there early, and I stuck my computer up on the treadmill to walk, because I like to recreate my treadmill desk situation when I'm walking, you know, at a conference. Again, looking like a lunatic for the people who are working out, and I'm there for 5 hours just walking. So I had, you know, finished my work, and I thought to myself, well, I'm on an actual treadmill. Treadmill desks like I have only go 4 miles an hour, so you can't run on them. And so I was on an actual treadmill, and I thought, why don't I try running? I hadn't run since 2003. The most I'd run in my whole life was 2 miles, and I convinced myself my whole life that I was a terrible runner, because hitherto I had been a terrible runner. And I was a kid in middle school who just like stopped during the 1 mile and walked the whole rest of the way. So I had just never been a good runner. And so I started running. I got to 1 mile, not winded. Got to 2 miles, not winded. Got to 6 miles that first time and just wasn't really tired. And what I realized is after this now 2.5 years of walking 20 and 30 mile days, my muscles had become just acclimated to doing that job. And so while it took a little bit of time to get the cardiovascular changes for like breathing down, I ended up being a runner. So when I was in Michigan for vacation, actually, for the first time running outside, I decided I would make a route that goes around this lake that we live near, by the lake we live near. And just to be extreme, I was like, what would it look like to do a half marathon around this lake? And one day went out and just did it. And it wasn't too bad, actually. And 2 days later, did it again. Turned out I was a runner after all this time and not really realizing that. You'll notice the second time I was slower, because 2 days later. But it was amazing. So now I had this new thing in my arsenal. When I'm out and about traveling, I could go running. You know, here I am in Vancouver. I was running around that island there. And it became this new way for me to sort of have a goal, too, to get better and faster and to be now this runner, this person I never thought I would be. And luckily, Fitbit now had their open API. So does Strava, very easy to interact with. Not so open APIs are the Apple HealthKit and Garmin, who refuses to have a good API. They do have one, you have to pay for it. It's a whole thing that I've yelled at them about. But so they are not as easy to integrate with. But I just want to give you a little bit of a taste, there we go, of what this looks like. And then, like I said, I'll produce a video on the side to show you what it looks like. And so let me just clear my current filter out here, and I'll go to, I have a little script in here to go to today. So I'll go to the current day. And if I want to import from Strava, I actually have under here this little Strava import. I'll just show you what it looks like. It just has a token, an ID, and it throws some requests using the new HTTP request. And then it ends up pulling in a table as JSON. There's an operation in jump to convert that back to a jump table. I do some summarization to clean it up, get rid of duplicate columns, some things like that. If I run this, you'll see what's going to happen. It's going to go out. You'll see some windows. And then it shows me yesterday that I ran. I have a streak for cardio is what I call it. I haven't run today. After this talk, maybe we'll see if it's raining. So it's at a -1. But the idea being that I can just do it that simply. For my Fitbit, it's the same thing. I have Fitbit date range and Fitbit last two. If I need to pull in a range of dates, I can specify them. Otherwise, I just click the last two. It's going to go out to the Fitbit servers, call it API, pull in things like steps, like distance. And it's going to pull in the dinner summaries, all the details there, and throw it in there. Man, 2,000 steps today? That's not good. So, by the way, just as an aside, the engineering SI operation and jump as a format for your column is really cool. I had no idea about that for a long time. And that does the 2.12K or the 40K. You don't have to have the long, you know, 40,000. It's just a really nice, nice format. Right, so imports are pretty straightforward there. That's easy. The health kit and XML parsings, I'll come back to in a little bit if I have time, and then some new challenges. So by November 2017, I had this whole thing about running. I was now a runner in my head, and I was getting steps that way, in addition to my treadmill desk. But there was a lot of changes that happened in November that sort of ended up throwing off my routines, kind of like you saw before. Let me go actually to filter this, and let's just peek ahead of where we were. And so tell November here. So I'll pull this one up. Actually, what I'm going to switch to, just because it's easier to look at this, I have a version of this graph that's just weekly. It just bins it every week. That's a lot easier to see, bigger trends. So I was nice and flat. I was good there. You know, I was doing a lot of weekly miles. But if I just peek ahead, you can see there's, you know, I go up a little bit, then I catch myself, go up a little bit, and keep going up. And so, oops, I went too far. It's foreshadowing. So for those of you in the back who can't see, there's just a bit of red that creeps in, and that weight starts ticking up. Not quite to the real red zone, but enough where, you know, this is catching my attention. So changes in November 2017. Well, there were some good and some bad. We found an all-you-can-eat sushi place near where we live now, and so that was probably a bad thing. I don't know. It is just sushi, but we eat too much of it, so that's fine. But Margo and I also bought a house, and that was a big deal. And we actually found that all-you-can-eat sushi place because it's near our house, so that is a constant problem. But there are some other hard changes. You know, they're not necessarily bad or good, but they're difficult. So the team I've been on for the last 4 years, I ended up changing roles in the division and had to say basically bye to really close friends after all this time. So changing teams is always a difficult thing. It's not as big as changing jobs or you know, companies, but still pretty big. So as I just showed in the weekly view, you know, I was ticking up, ticking up, ticking up. And by the time I got to May and we had to take that home office and, you know, pull it down again, which is always throwing off routines, you know, ripping apart things, not that fast. It took like 2 hours. You know, some things we didn't want to disassemble, with all apologies to anybody who is from IKEA here. We didn't want to dismantle this one, so I just pushed it off, which was fun. Yeah, it comes apart quickly that way, doesn't it? Never to be reassembled. No, that was fun, though. It was very loud. And then we went on a big trip. So Margo graduated from her master's program. So this was from the top of Mandalay Bay in Singapore. These are the super trees we saw. They're just beautiful. This is that those eyes, the beautiful indoor sort of ecosystems they built. We got over to Sydney, and Sydney by night was just beautiful. We got, because we're nerds, we got over to Hobbiton in Auckland in New Zealand and Queenstown. And then we got to the furthest place away from Durham we could possibly get, 11,560 miles, which is Rottnest Island in the west coast of Australia, which is a beautiful place, but we didn't go there for the beauty. Does anyone know what's on Rottnest Island, what we went looking for?
Crabs.
Crabs? No. Any other guess?
It's a small kangaroo.
Oh, do you know what it's called?
Kangaroo.
Small kangaroo is pretty good, though. Yeah, it's a little marsupial. A little marsupial that we went looking for called a quokka. And a quokka looks like this. This one I loved. He was really, really friendly. Or she. I'm not sure, actually. And so just for size, you can see there I am hanging out with this quokka. This is one I liked. If they had an album, I figured this would be the album cover for this quokka. So I liked him a lot. We went looking for the quokka because the quokka, since she was a kid, was Margot's favorite, most sought-after animal and only lives on Rottnest Island on the west coast of Australia, off Perth. So it's really hard to get to, like you saw, the furthest possible place in the world we can go to. So we literally built that entire trip around going to this island to see this little quokka, because this is something that Margo wanted to do for her whole life. And me being an opportunist, I thought that, hey, this is the time I should propose to her. Because if she's going to have a highlight of the trip, it's going to be the quokkas, and I need to latch on to that. So here we are. Getting engaged with a quokka as our witness. Yeah. And they love taking selfies. You know, they're really sweet. They don't care. They're just like, I want to go eat a leaf, you know. But you have to catch them at the right time, and then they'll smile for you. So we got engaged in Rottnest Island. It turns out, thinking about it, you know, as I was on the trip, but then I got back, I did this. 11,560 miles, and I had walked, since I met Margot, 10,052. So I didn't quite get there. But then I realized I met Marco in San Diego, and San Diego is 9,389 miles to Rottnest Island. So I had walked far enough to have gotten to where we got engaged. We can't walk to Australia, but if you could, you know. So I thought that was a fun little statistic. So September 2017, we had moved. I rebuilt my home office a little bit different from before. I had my biggest month of ever in 1.2 million steps in October. And I really had this re-energizing feeling. It had been winter or coming up on winter, so at my home treadmill, an actual running treadmill now, I put this big screen in front of me so I could pretend like I'm running outside. It's actually great. I just lose myself in it. It's wonderful. But the weather was still nice, so I got to run outside, and you know, it's beautiful to run outside. And I was getting better at working with Strava and Garmin data with their metrics. Garmin makes it hard. I actually have to go to their website, open up all my different runs, and then go and save each one as a TPX file. But then Jump does a really good job. Jump can parse those XMLs really, really efficiently, which gives me new insights. One thing I thought was cool, I was interested in what time of day I run. Of course, I can know this lots of ways. But here was a cool plot I thought of. Like, looking across the x-axis is an implied date axis. I just took the labels off. And then on the y is showing the length of the run, but also the time. It's the activity trace. So you can see I had a really long run here. That was the first time I ran a full marathon. And I have some halves here that you saw before. And so I can see duration of running time there. It also meant I can use, since there's GPS, my watch tracks it, I can, you know, see where I've run. This is right near SAS campus. That's running around SAS. This is a run I do pretty often through Umstead Park, running from the parking lot, do a big loop and come back. It's a half marathon the distance. This is one of my first long runs. That's the Tobacco Trail. So it's really fun to be able to visualize these things and see them. Here's one that I thought was fun. This is the distance in meters, because that's what Garmin spits out, and speed in meters per second. If you don't intuitively get that, it's basically two times that as miles per hour. And this is how fast I'm running based on how far I've run. And so it sort of, you know, ticks down, which kind of makes sense. I get tired. But if you break it up with whether it's outside or a treadmill, that's a very different pattern. And this is something I've just noticed I do. On a treadmill, I sort of keep pushing the up button every few miles, and so I tick up faster and faster. So it's a different sort of, it's anti-fatiguing in a way. I'm sure I'm getting more fatigued, but I'm challenged by the fact that I'm on a treadmill. So I thought that was kind of neat. Since we're short on time, I can come back to some of these if we have it. But notice that, yeah, there was definitely something changed for me. I had, again, this big block of days, if you can't see in the back, all this green I love to see, you know, a few times where I hit some red. But I'm, you know, watching when I'm eating, and I'm kind of getting down from that red point here, which set off the alarm bells for me, heading downwards and downwards to this number that I've lusted after for years, you know, of getting to this particular weight. But it turned out right around this time, I got to the weight that I was when I first met Margot. And that is kind of fortuitous, because remember that Costco picture? That's actually a wedding picture. So Margot and I actually got married at the Costco we met at on November 29th, this last November 29th, on the three-year anniversary of meeting each other, inside the store, actually. There we are inside the store. It's a ridiculous story that requires a whole other talk to talk about, but you can search for Costco wedding couple, and we made a bunch of news articles, so you can read about it there. I was curious to know how many steps it had been since this day zero, really, of this transformation for myself. And it had been up to the wedding day, and it was 14,143 miles, which is really where this talk's title come from. You know, this was the transformation of myself from really the worst time for me to the best time. And it took me 14,000 miles. So we'll come back to that in a second, just to give you a preview of the effect of married life, which everyone wants to know. Now you laugh, but that's rough, right? Hold on, there is a reason though. It's not just the married life. It turns out I got a stress fracture. All that running extremely, and if you look back, this is running at the top. You know, one thing my doctor asked me is like, oh, how many rest days do you take? I'm like, I don't take rest days. Why would you do that? I'm not tired. He's like, well, it's not just your muscles being tired, it's your bones. You got to be really careful. So while I built up so much endurance with all the walking, I was running half marathons every week, basically, just for fun. And I told him that. He's like, well, of course you got a stress fracture. So that was really rough. I did go to radiology and get the MRI data, and you can do different kind of density scans. And so this is a vascular version that I was able to pull out. You can download the open source software to play with the densities, and that's a vascular scan. I think that's so cool. Data is awesome. But I had to basically take a break from all that running, so that definitely changed that period of time. But I'm happy to say I can run now. I'm taking my rest days. You may have seen me out doing the lake the other day. So now I'm sort of back on track. So this is a weekly view of this entire journey for me, and it kind of covers all the things we talked about. So if I'll just, you know, look through the weights, you know, that first big series of time for me, the slow escalation, getting ready to move, the moving, being stressed about a new place, reinvigorated to make a change, you know, then even more reinvigorated, reaching a steady state. I think I added running pretty close to here. There's where running started. That's weekly miles. You know, and then sort of bouncing around, and then really a big push for knowing that I wanted to get to the place I was for the wedding, and then trickling off once I realized I had that stress fracture, and then back to it. So I've been able to run for the last few weeks, which has been pretty huge. So new beginnings really are often disguised, for me, as painful endings. One other thing that I don't know why I love Lao Tzu so much in this talk, but if you don't change directions, you may end up where you're heading, and that's one big thing I learned about myself. Where I point, I'm just going to go. So if I'm pointing into a good direction, I'm going to head that way. If I'm pointing another direction, that's where I'm going to go. And I guess I need to end with the most famous Lao Tzu quote ever. The journey of 1,000 miles begins with a single step, and I'll just modify that to say the journey of 14,000 miles begins with a single well-recorded step, because after all, I am completely narcissistic. So thank you so much.
Wow, I was expecting to be entertained, but that was inspirational as well as entertaining. And since I've got the microphone, I'm going to ask the first question.
Yeah, please do. Yeah.
I've tried this before, and what happens is I'm really good when the graph's going down,
right.
And then I stop, because I know I'm going back up again, and I don't want to see the up. What made you motivated to keep doing the
That's
you
a,
knew you were going bad, why do
yeah.
you keep logging all the bad stuff?
That's a really good question. It was a commitment I made to myself that I will every day open up that health data set. And even if I don't look, I'm going to click those run buttons to get the data and import. And just the agreement with myself to open up that file and to face it a little bit kept me doing it. There are times where I would go a few days and I would have to, like, okay, fill in those last ones. But it was making that covenant with yourself, really, that no matter what, I'm going to import the data, because data is too precious to throw away. Yeah.
Great. We have a couple of minutes.
Yeah.
Anybody got questions for Julian? I'll come down with the microphone. I'll walk fast.
25 seconds.
First of all, thank you. That was hilarious and excellent. I think now more people who don't do anything with statistics or data in their regular life are being exposed to more data. Do you think in general that there's like communities of Fitbit users that are looking at their data in different ways? What's your opinion
on that? Yeah, absolutely. There's a whole movement, the quantified self movement. And if you search for it, that's why the QS Access app was called that. It's quantified self. And they have forums. There are, you know, lots of people on there discussing these challenges and these solutions really to it. And I learned about that first from Shannon, who's up here too. Also, I don't know if she's a narcissist, but she's shaking her head yes. But yeah, quantified self. So if you search that term, you'll get a good listing of people who are also engaged in this. But I think naively everybody is. The way Fitbit even positions their app or MyFitnessPal, they give you some of this as a sort of spoon-fed to you. But I think, you know, taking it that next step requires something like Jump, some location where you can bring it all together. I mean, I didn't show you anything with the data for micro-eating, all the data you can do with Text Explorer. I mean, Jump is the best place to do all this. I can't even imagine how hard it would be to do any of this in other software, and let alone put it all together in one place. Yeah. Yeah.
Any other questions? You're going to make me walk back again?
Oh, I'm sorry.
So much work. Yeah, I got to.
I really enjoyed the talk. I was just curious. I saw that you talked about your sodium and everything. Were you actually inputting or were you importing like a food log or something like that?
That's a great question. Yes. So MyFitnessPal is what I was using to track everything. And, some entries are going to be less accurate than others. But in my table, I have it hidden here, but I have detailed basically for all, here I'll go to MyFitnessPal, detail, nutrition, all the detailed things that they'll give me, I'll import. And so that gives you the ability, certain times it's not there, but basically you have all this stuff based on what foods people have entered. And so I can do all sorts of things looking at this. That was one of the early on things I looked at other than just sort of my goals, but also just like how I've done. I had this nutrition heat map. And so looking at, day to day, carbs, calories, fat, protein, sodium, fiber, and sort of seeing based on this color gradient how I was doing. So yeah, having the micronutrition stuff is really powerful, I think. Yeah, of course.
Alcohol's not there.
It's logged differently. I do have that. Yes.
Any other questions?
If we have a second, just because that question brings it up, you can ask another question. I can do this at the same time, but I do have to show you something that's funny. So I have all the food I've eaten for the last blah, 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 blah days. Okay, so don't worry about that. But let's look at, this is breakfast, dinner, and lunch. So I log snacks as alcohol. And so I was like looking at like what kind of alcohol I eat or consume. But here's the funny thing. So you may not know this about North Carolina. I lived in California before. You can buy liquor in the store. In North Carolina, you can't. You have to buy liquor in a specialty store, basically, for it. Because, United States, blue laws, puritanical nonsense, it's fine. So if we look at just snacks and then do a data filter based on date, the date I moved to North Carolina, I'll put that in here. So before moving, bourbon, scotch, vodka, those were the biggest categories of things. And then post-moving, you would think, do blue laws work? Did I stop drinking? Like, no, I just switched over to like white wine. And so it basically supplanted the exact same thing. And so all it was is just, it was one thing I've learned about myself, I will take the path of least resistance a lot of times. And for fitness, that meant making sure the path of least resistance was a good one for me. But what I've just realized here is like, yeah, like blue laws work. I didn't want to go to that extra store. So I just went to the grocery store. But it's really fun. Text Explorer gives you a lot of things you can explore with your own data, so that's fun.
I'm so glad you showed that. It's human. If you had said, I don't drink, that would have been, there's no way I can do it.
No.
You can tell the accent, right? Okay, thank you very much, a big hand for...
thank you, everyone.